and welcome to this weekend's Melons Better Driving video. This time I want to discuss the difference between something that I feel a lot of people don't understand, grip versus handling. Okay, allow me to explain this, because at first that might seem very odd. Okay, the thing is, I've heard a lot of people telling me, oh no, this car has a lot of grip, it handles really well. And then I'll get into it, and it's got a lot of grip, and they're right about that, but it handles awful. And what I mean by that is, there's a lot of grip, but there's not much of a cornering balance. Because handling is more about the balance between understeer and oversteer. This car handles really well, despite not really having all that much grip. The car that I'm driving right now, this is a Renault Mega RS265. It's a fantastic little hot hatch. The French are just the masters of hot hatches, they really are. And I'm driving around Cadwell GP circuit, one of the best circuits in project cars, if you can find this rhythm and flow, which is very elusive on this track. And also try to get your actual braking point there perfect, because I find that it's really easy to lock your brakes up there. Really easy. But anyways, earlier today I had somebody telling me that the latest generation Civic Type R is the best handling Civic Type R or Type R that Honda has ever made. And then I thought of two cars. I thought of the Integra Type R. I guess I thought of three cars, because I'll count the NSX in this, even though it's not front-wheel drive. But I thought of three cars. I thought of the Integra Type R DC2, which was nicknamed the best handling front-wheel drive car in the world in its day. I thought of the Civic Type R EP3, which was also sold as, like, SIR in various other markets and so on. That car is my idea of very fantastic handling hot hatch, sort of like this car, but just purely because it spends so much time on three wheels and just is crazy to drive. It's a fantastic little car for my idea. Like, I like my cars to oversteer a little bit more than the other average people. And then I thought of the Honda NSX-R, which, let's be honest, if Ayrton Senna is going to design a car, he's going to want it to be neutral. That car was known for its neutral steering, and it's just incredible driving feel. Now, that car just didn't quite have as much grip, like outright grip, as some of the Ferraris and Porsches and so on of the day, but what it lacked in the outright grip, it made up for in its balance. This car wasn't the fastest at the apex or anything, but it doesn't need to be the fastest at the apex, because a lot of cars, ooh, bottomed out. Sorry, little Mega. Oh, yeah. Okay, so that, I keep running off there because I sort of lose the grip when the car bottoms out, but yeah, this car could deal with a little bit stiffer suspension, I think, and a potentially slightly higher ride height in that corner. But otherwise, it's a fantastic handling car. Which is, that's what I mean by this, though. It's like, this, you can see the tire smoke and everything. This car doesn't have a lot of grip. You know, it's not a, like a Formula One car that drives on rails. If you want to toss it in sideways into a corner, you can toss it in sideways into a corner. Right? Like, you can get it sideways, you can spin this car, you can crash this car. It's not overly simple to drive like some other cars that have a lot of grip and understeer a lot. Like, this car, it's what I would call a neutral balance as far as a front-wheel drive car can go. And this is the Renault Megane again that I'm talking about. But then you've got cars that have amazing amounts of grip. Grip, just grip, grip, grip. And they're on the racing slicks, and they weigh like 1,800 pounds and whatever. But the people just use the tires. They don't use the suspension setup. They don't sort of set the car up neutral. They just use the tires. they say, well, I've got the best, grippiest tires in the market. I don't need to set the suspension up, like, perfectly to the point that it kind of slightly oversteers and you've got the perfect neutral steering. No. A lot of people, they go out and they make these cars with literally... Oh. Okay, that time was just on me. That time was my mistake there. Oh. But they go out every time with these cars that aren't fully optimized. Because when I'm talking about steering and handling, I'm not talking about grip outright, because anybody can make a car grippy, but not anybody can make a car handle well. When I'm talking about handling, I'm talking about the balance in the car. Like, does the car understeer, does the car oversteer, or does it have a balance? Because a nice handling car will have a nice balance. You don't want to have excess oversteer, you don't want to have excess understeer. You want to have a car that when you turn it in, it turns the way that you expect it to, time and time and time again. It grips, it has good, you know, balance through the corner. That way you're not going to lose time against somebody who has even worse tires just because they've got a better suspension setup or whatever. You want to have a car that really just masters. Whoa, that's bumpy. I should stay off that curb. But yeah, a lot of people I've found making this exact mistake. They say, well, my car has lots of grip. I don't need to worry about blah, 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 suspension setup or something. But the problem with that idea, with that logic, if you will, is that I have a friend whose nickname is Shrapnel. Now, Shrapnel, he's a fantastic guy. He's come to my house quite a few times, and we've been sort of working together to fine-tune the suspension on his Hyundai Accent, which still has Hyundai Accent, like, factory, whatever, tires. Very small, 175 wide tires. But his car, it's so lightweight, and it's got such a good suspension setup that it doesn't need those big wide tires to corner well. It actually out-corners just about anything on the road. Like, I tried to keep up with him on one particularly curvy road in my Subaru, and I was finding it to be difficult just because he was able to carry so much apex speed because of his suspension setup. And I thought, wow, that's incredible that you can make a car that fast on 175 wide all-season tires. But that's just the thing, though, isn't it? It's... A lot of times you have people who, they genuinely set the car up so perfectly, even on all-season tires, you can just sense that they really have amazing grip. So this 2000 and... I guess it's 2012. Shrapnel, if you hear this and I'm wrong, I'm sorry, don't kill me. But it's a relatively new model. Which, of course, there's nothing wrong with that, but you typically think of new cars as being, like, undersprung and very soft and very heavy. But his car isn't anymore, because he was able to just fix the small flaws with it, if you will. He was able to restore the essential essence of the car, just the essential basics of it, and make it back into a very awesome sporty car. To make it handle well, to make it turn well, to make everything better with it. And he really did a fantastic job of setting this car up, because he took my advice to heart, where I was telling him, okay, like, if you think that it has this much understeer, then, like, let's change this, and let's set this damper rate at, like, this, and we were really working together on it, and we really slowed down, took our time, adjusted the spring rates, the dampers, we adjusted the ride height, we adjusted everything to try to make it as perfect as we could. And then, what's going to happen now, when he puts on his grippier tires, he has a baseline that he just needs to make small adjustments to the dampers in order to basically make that car one of the best handling cars in the world. And we sort of set the car up in mind that it will require a very smooth driving style, because that's the driving style that we both have. And so we were able to create this sort of ideal setup for the two of us, because we both have the same driving style, and at least in some regards. I'm a lot more aggressive than he is in terms of sawing at the wheel, just because I like to run my car so loose, so oversteer happy, tail happy, that I have to correct every once in a while, that he doesn't even have to correct it, because he doesn't run them quite as extremely sideways as I do. And that's fine, but what really ends up happening, though, is this ability to set the car up to be so happy that it doesn't understeer nor oversteer, because the driver is just driving it to its limit, never over it. And then the car is so well poised and so well balanced that you can just sense that there's something that's changed about it. Even when you look at this Hyundai Accent, it's rolling around on steel wheels, and it doesn't particularly look overly fast until you realize that it's very much lower than the factory, and the coilovers and the suspension work on it really, really make a massive difference to the handling of that car. And I look at people with, like, these 285 wide tires on their Subarus, and they've never really even adjusted the spring rates and dampers or anything to fit to try to make the car as fast as it can be. Ooh. Yeah. I'm gonna change the ride height on this car. I'm not really satisfied with that. I wonder how I can do that within Project Cars. But essentially, you always want to try to make the car as amazing as you can right from the onset. Oh, you can't change ride height. Well, that sucks. But I find that a lot of people are instantly drawn to the idea of just slapping on these much grippier, much better tires, but they don't really understand the suspension work that goes into getting the most from the tires, where I call it tire optimization, where you want to basically get the absolute most out of the tires you have on the car, regardless of whether they're racing slicks or whether they're all seasons or whether they're wide tires or whether they're narrow tires. And that's why you set your camber and your toe and... Whoa, really cold tires. Okay. I'm gonna have to drive accordingly. I try to make this video interesting by never really slowing down, but when you're on cold tires, you kind of should slow down and let the tires warm up. But it's just such an amazing thing when you see a car that's on really narrow tires, and it's outrunning these big tires cars, simply because the suspension work and the driver's practice and so on really bring out the most of the tires. It's tire optimization, like you're optimizing the tire that you have, instead of just being in this big battle for having the grippiest tire. Because grippy tires, they have more road noise, they have, what do you call it, they pick up stones and damage the paint, they have worse fuel economy, they wear out faster. It's a lot more expensive and a lot more troublesome to have these grippy tires than it is to have the suspension that's set up for everything to be... Damn it. Okay, that was really, really not how you enter that corner with cold tires. Keep hoping that the tires will be warmed up, but this car is taking a long time for the tires to warm up, and I'm not sure why. I guess it's because you don't brake enough. Tires aren't getting the brake temperature into them. Anyways, I'll keep warming the tires up, trying to get back up to pace. But it's so amazing to have the tires optimized, and you will be sort of at the ragged edge of control the whole time. But it's beautiful because this ragged edge of control is so much higher that when you drive at the speeds you used to drive at, suddenly it's simple because your suspension and the brakes and everything are all optimized to be flawless and perfect, and you have the perfect sort of neutral steering. And if you don't have that neutral steering, I'm wondering, like, how can you deal with having excess understeer or excess oversteer when you could have that perfectly flawless setup? And I mean, it's okay if you enjoy it. If you want to tell me that you just have more fun with the car that oversteers, that's amazing. That's fantastic. That's a good, fun idea. Go for it. But if you are genuinely interested in time attack, you need to think about tire optimization, as I call it, which is essentially the suspension work that makes the most out of your tires. Because it does no good if you have, you know, 15-inch wide tires, and then you have basically Daihatsu suspension on it. You're going to have so much body roll that the car will probably roll over with that much grip and that much body roll. You're screwed. Like, there's no chance of you actually making that fast, even though you've got those tires, in which case you're just wasting your money putting these big, wide, grippy tires on, because the wider and the grippier a tire is, the more it's going to come over. Anyways, that was frustrating. Doesn't seem like anything's broken. Always that first corner. I hate it because the car bottoms out and then it's unpredictable what happens after it bottoms out. But anybody who has ever decided, I want to do time attack, you need to think about how to use your tires effectively. Because especially if you're doing something like autocross where your tire choices are limited, you can't go above a certain grip threshold, like you can't go below a certain tread wear, which typically, in other words, means you can't have more than this amount of grip. So if you have something like that, where your tires are a set size and they're a set tread wear and a set grip level, then you really need to make the most of the grip you have instead of just trying to add more. And that is tire optimization. And that is why my friend Shrapnel, his Hyundai Accent, which we're going to call the Shrapnel Edition Accent, that's why it's such an amazing car, because it's literally the perfect example of something that is tire optimization. Because I had my 2011 WRX, a wide body Subaru, and I tried to keep up with him in the corners, but with the factory suspension I had body roll and I had basically a lot more weight to toss around, and I wasn't making the most of the tires. Even though I had these big, wide, grippy tires, they just weren't the same. They weren't as effectively used, I should say. They weren't the same effective solution. They just sort of were a budget fix for the problems that the rest of the car had. And that's okay, but if you have the coilovers anyways, especially if you have the coilovers anyways, it's time for you to go out there and try to make the car as neutral as possible so it doesn't understeer or oversteer. And I'm going to give you an example here. I go into this corner, I've got nothing. There's no tires were spinning there. I didn't have the front tires sliding out, I didn't have the back tires sliding out. It's just 100% grip. And I got through that corner very quickly because of that. Right there, heck, you can sense a little bit of understeer. You could change the suspension setup a little bit, but I don't want to optimize my car for that corner, because that corner is one of the least important corners. This corner right here, it's a nice example of a corner that the car doesn't really have an understeer or oversteer. This one, there's a lot of understeer, so why I'm on the grass on the outside there. I could change that, but the car is optimized elsewhere. And I haven't fiddled with the suspension, I haven't created a setup that works for me yet. And it bottoms out a lot. Yeah. Anyways, I hope that you've enjoyed the rant. I know I said it like 100,000 times, but it's genuinely very important. So I'm drilling it into your head because it's such a crucial thing in time attack to make the most of your tires and autocross and racing, anything where you're given a tire and you can't just out-tire the person beside you. You have to do it, pretty much. You have to know about how to use your tires the most effectively as you can. And I know it kind of comes across as repetitive, and I'm sorry about that, but I'm really hoping that you come away from this video thinking, you know, he said it like 8 times, but he really had a point there, and he made it. I know he made it a lot of times, but I'm hoping that that's sort of what you will take away from this video. Because I'm really hoping that people will understand the whole premise of, you know, really using their car the most effectively as possible. Trying to set the car up with the perfect steering, the perfect... perfect setup is such a pleasure to drive too. Like, comment, subscribe, share a video around, post it up on your Facebook wall, post it wherever you want, but especially comment, tell me what you think. I'm hoping that I can make the videos as exciting and interesting as possible, and I'm really looking for feedback, because feedback really helps me with improving the quality of the videos. So, if you tell me what you think of the video, I can make it more interesting to you, because that's my goal, is to create interesting, exciting, fascinating content that people hadn't considered before, or reiterate and further explain content that people already sort of grasp, but they don't fully understand it. Anything that you have, any suggestions, any content that you want to see covered, let me know about it. Send me a message, send me a comment. I promise you, I will read them, I will reply to them, and I will, if it's a good suggestion, make a video about it. And it's that simple, but I feel like it's one of the most genuine things that I can do. Really just to say, hey, guys, if you have a question, I'll answer it. So, thank you for watching, and have a good weekend. I will catch you in the next video. See you guys.